Welcome to Sunday morning worship at Our Savior's Lutheran Church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. Our Savior's is a congregation of people forgiven in Christ, whose mission is to proclaim the good news and connect faith to everyday life. We are glad that you've chosen to worship with us as we celebrate Palm Sunday. Our traditional worship, one of our 6 weekly services, will begin in a few moments.
All of you here, but we want to extend our warmest welcome to those who are guests and visitors with us today, as well as those who join us by way of our television broadcast. If you haven't done so already here in the sanctuary, now would be a great time to pass the welcome pads, sign your name, pass it down to your neighbor. This is one of the ways that we try to learn each other's names, as well as have a way to extend a little OSL hospitality to those who are visitors in our midst. And while you're doing that, I'd like to share a few words of announcements with you. Of course, we're now entering into Holy Week, and we want you all to be aware of our Holy Week worship schedule. We've printed it in the bulletin. It's on our website, out on Facebook. But especially for those that are watching on television, we want you to know that this week we'll gather for a healing worship service at 6:30 on Tuesday in the chapel. Maundy Thursday worship will take place at noon and at 6:30 in the evening, with the evening service featuring a Living Last Supper presentation. Good Friday will offer a dramatic tenebrae service at 6:30 in the evening. Holy Saturday worship will be at 5 o'clock, a service that will focus on light and hope in the time between Good Friday and Easter Sunday. And then, of course, Easter Sunday, we pull out all the stops and offer a grand celebration of the empty tomb with a sunrise worship service at 7 o'clock here in the sanctuary, and then our normal times, 8:45 and 11, in both the sanctuary and in the Celebrate Center. Join us, and be sure to invite others to join us as well. Offer that schedule to them, or take a card off of one of the tables in the gathering place. Use that as a way of inviting others to join us for worship this Holy Week. We also invite you to provide Easter plants, maybe in honor of a special person or occasion, in memory of a loved one, or just in thanksgiving for God's amazing blessings. You can stop by the Information Center today in order to order your plant. While you're there, you can also sign up at the Information Center to be part of the procession of Easter plants here in festive worship next Sunday. Those who sign up for that procession receive an added perk. You'll have your seats reserved for you, and we'll take care of that so that you can be a part of bringing the flowers in to decorate our worship space. The OSL caretakers invite you to lend a hand this Tuesday to do a little spring cleaning in anticipation of our Easter celebrations. Stop by the church on Tuesday between the hours of 3 and 8 in order to do what you can to help spruce this place up a little bit, and know that pizza will be offered to all who help. Now, for all of you men who are here, there's still a chance to be part of the Living Last Supper presentation this Thursday. If you're interested, talk to our worship director, Gene Lavasser. And be sure to check out the special Lenten and Easter activities in the library this week. Details about all that's happening in the library are in your bulletin. Also, the Board of Caring Ministries will be sponsoring an Easter egg hunt in the prayer garden next Sunday morning. In fact, all morning long. So make plans to be a part of that as well. And finally, if you came in the south entrance at least, you are probably aware that the Bloodmobile is here and I believe still taking walk-in donors. So do what you can to help save a life by donating blood. Now, this is Palm Sunday, as I mentioned. Hopefully you received your palm branches when you came in to worship. They're not just for decoration, they are for us to use as we worship today, waving them high as we sing our hosannas to God. And so I encourage you to do so throughout the worship service. Let's be active in our worship this morning with our palm branches. With that, I invite you to stand as you're able, and begin worship with the order of confession and forgiveness. We gather here in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Together let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. We pray. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ has been given to die for us, and it is for his sake that God forgives us all our sins. So as a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and only by his authority, I therefore declare to each of you the entire forgiveness of all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. As forgiven people of God, let's share that peace with one another. Having shared the peace of the Lord, we now grab our palm branches and we clear our throats. Let's sing our praises to our God. Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Hosanna, King of all, you reign over all. So reign in our lives. Triumph over sin and death and the power of evil, and teach us to follow in your footsteps. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you. God speaks to us in scripture, preaching, song, and prayer. A reading from Psalms. Save us, we beseech you, O Lord. O Lord, we beseech you, give us success. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord is God, and he has given us light. Bind the festal procession with branches up to the horns of the altar. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, and I will extol you. I give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever. Word of God, word of life. A reading from Mark. When they were approaching Jerusalem at Bethphage and Bethany, near the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples and said to them, "Go into the village ahead of you, and immediately as you enter it, you will find tied there a colt that has never been ridden. Untie it and bring it. If anyone says to you, 'Why are you doing this?' just say this, 'The Lord needs it,' and will send it back here immediately." They went away and found a colt near a door outside in the street. As they were untying it, some of the bystanders said to them, "What are you doing untying the colt?" They told them what Jesus had said, and they allowed them to take it. Then they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks on it, and he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, and others spread leafy branches that they had cut in the fields. Then those who went ahead and those who were following shouted, "Hosanna! Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." Then he entered Jerusalem and went into the temple. And when he had looked around at everything, as it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. Word of God, word of life.
You may be seated. I'd like to invite the younger children to come forward for a kid talk. Join me up here on the steps, if you would, please. And bring your palm branches, if you remember. It's all right. If you don't, but if you want to bring it with you, that's going to be fun. Come and join me on the steps. It's so nice to see all of you here this morning. I want to ask you a question. How many of you like celebrations? Just raise your hand if you like to celebrate. Yeah? Me too. What are some things that we celebrate? Yeah.
Easter,
of course. What else?
A birthday.
Yes, what else?
Christmas.
Halloween. There's lots of things we like to celebrate. What are some of the things that we do when we celebrate?
They give us a birthday cake.
Oh, yeah, birthday cake, special food, right? If it's your birthday, sometimes mom and dad will say, what would you like to eat on your birthday? And you get your favorite food. What else when we celebrate? Say it again. It was there and then it was gone. That happens to me all the time. That's okay. What else?
God.
Yeah, we celebrate God, of course. But what do we do when we celebrate? Owen. Okay, we be with our family. Yes. You can celebrate your golden birthday. Yeah, sometimes we'll sing, right, when we celebrate. Sometimes we will actually make lots of noise because we get so excited. Sometimes we're celebrating sporting events. I love basketball, and I was at a basketball game this last Tuesday cheering for my favorite team, Augustana University. And it was an amazing game, let me just say that. I mean, there was lots of noise because the crowd was so excited about what was happening. It was a well-played game, well-fought, but you know what? Augie won. And when Augie won, the crowd went nuts. They were yelling, they were cheering, they were clapping, they were high-fiving. Want to give me a high-five, anyone? There we go. Yes, they were maybe even dancing. It was an amazing celebration. Sorry to hang. There we go. Well, that's kind of what we do in worship sometimes, even though it looks and feels different. Did you know that when we come to worship, when we come to church, one of the things that we want to do is to celebrate God's amazing love? And that's no different today. Right? I wonder if maybe we could make a little noise as a way of celebrating God's amazing love, as a way of praising God. Do you guys feel like making some noise?
Yes.
Maybe if we ask all of them to help, we might actually raise the roof a little bit, or at least let the neighbors know we're here. What do you think? I'm going to say, to God we lift up our praise, and then I'm going to say, hip, hip, and what do you say? That's right. You say hooray. We'll do that three times, three cheers for Jesus, all right? To God we lift up our praise. Hip, hip.
Hooray.
I think you got more in you. Come on. Hip, hip.
Hooray.
One more time. Hip, hip.
Hooray.
Wow, you raised the roof on that one. Nice job. I don't think we broke the glass. It wasn't that loud. But you know what? Today is a good day to celebrate Jesus. Do you know why? What day is today? Yes.
Palm
Sunday. That's why we're carrying palm branches, right? It's the day that we remember when Jesus rode into Jerusalem on the back of a donkey, and people along the way cut off some branches and started waving them in the air. And they would take off their coats and lay them down on the ground so that he would have a smooth place to ride over. And they were shouting. They were celebrating, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. It was a great celebration. Well, I think today could be a great celebration. It already has been. Wonderful music, which some of you provided. I wonder if today our celebration might continue through worship with all of us, you included, waving those branches as we sing, as we celebrate God's amazing love. And I wonder if you could take these branches home with you and continue to wave them all week long, remembering that Jesus came to save us from our sin, and that's worth celebrating. Can you do that? I think you can. Let's pray, shall we? You repeat after me. Dear God, today we celebrate,
because you sent us Jesus
to save us from our sin.
May our joyful noise
help others see
your goodness and love.
And all of God's children said,
amen.
Amen.
Thanks for coming and joining me today. You can head back to your seats as we sing another Hosanna song. Wave those branches.
Dear hearers of the Word of God, grace to you and peace from God our Father, from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Good and gracious God, we thank you that on this day you rode into the city to shouts of Hosanna, save us, rescue us, that you would give us your life, that we may have salvation. So be with us this week as we enter now into Holy Week. Amen. If Willie Markson's observation that the Gospels are passion narratives with extended introductions is correct, then we are now at the beginning, or we are now at the end of the introduction. And the center of Mark's telling of the good news of Jesus Christ begins. It's at hand. On this day, on this Palm Sunday, the Christian church throughout the world celebrates with palm branches and shouts of Hosanna, Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. It is the beginning of the final week of Jesus' earthly ministry as he, by week's end, will complete the work that he has come to do. Of this day, the prophet Zechariah foretold, speaking of the coming of the King of Zion, writing, "See, your King comes to you righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey." Now Mark, the gospel writer, gives us a few of the details of this day, how Jesus sent two of his disciples ahead of the rest of them into the village ahead in order to get a donkey. And he instructs them and he tells them that those who will ask what they're doing, to simply tell them that the Lord needs it and he will send it back immediately. And so the disciples do as they're told, and they find the donkey just as Jesus said it would be, and they respond to the people who ask them what they're doing, simply that the Lord needs it. And so the stage is now set. Jesus is ready to fulfill the words and the promise of Zechariah. Bringing the donkey to Jesus, the disciples then throw their cloaks over the back of it, and Jesus sits on the donkey and he begins his entry into Jerusalem. As Jesus enters into the city, many people spread their cloaks and they cut down branches from the fields and they lay them before Jesus as they welcome their king. And those who went ahead and those who followed behind shouted, "Hosanna, save us, rescue us. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our ancestor David. Hosanna in the highest heaven." As Jesus enters, the people's shouts of Hosanna declare their hopes that the one riding on the donkey, Jesus of Nazareth, would be the one who has been promised, the one who has come to save them and to bring the Davidic kingdom to them. Hosanna, they shout. Blessed is this one, they declare. Let our hope be in him. It's important to remember about this day isn't necessarily the donkey or the palm branches, the cloaks, or the encounter the disciples had with those in the village. What's important about this day is what Jesus is doing. He is coming to you, righteous and bringing salvation. And by the end of the week, Jesus will do exactly what the people are shouting and asking him to do. He will rescue them. He will save them. Not from what they think their problem is, but what their true problem is. He will save them through his own death and resurrection from their sin and death, a twist in the story that leaves them shocked and stunned. You see, all the other rulers they've known and we've known, whether they're kings, prime ministers, presidents, or potentates, cannot make the same promise Jesus makes. Bill Clinton might have felt our pain, but Jesus Christ actually takes it into his own body as he takes your sins, my sins, and the sins of the world into himself so that they're no longer on us, but they are now in Jesus. And there is the promise for you today. Salvation unto us has come, writes the hymn writer. By God's free grace and favor, we didn't earn it. We didn't deserve it or merit it. We didn't even will Jesus to do this. But Jesus Christ, God's Son, come down from heaven, born of the Virgin, born under the law, has come to bring you salvation, to save you. Jesus, you see, is Hosanna. Well, these days you might be feeling the burn, or you might be hoping to cruise to the White House, pun intended, by the way. But none of the politicians who go on ad nauseum making all kinds of promises they won't keep are going to be able to do what Jesus promises to do. All the promises they make that they're going to make your lives better will come up, will end up falling far short. They, like the ones who've come before you, the politicians that we know, will surely fail what they've spoken, and they will fail with what our expectations for them are. One moment you may feel all trumped up with excitement, but it will certainly give way to dismay. Even King David, you see, is not immune from his own sinful behavior as he takes Bathsheba, another man's wife, and then for fear of being caught, he covers it up by having Uriah killed. You see, there's one Savior of the world, and it's not our favorite politician. The Savior's Jesus Christ. And unlike all of the politicians that have come in the past and surely will come in the future, Jesus is different. You see, you won't be getting endless emails from Jesus asking for money to get him elected. You won't be asked to do your part in the campaign because Jesus, by his own will, has decided to be your Savior by giving up his own life on the cross for you. So instead of giving and doing your part, you will simply receive. Now, if that sounds a bit too much like a government handout for your taste, I have some even worse news for you yet. Because receiving Christ's benefits is far easier than receiving government benefits. In fact, Jesus doesn't even limit who can and cannot receive his benefits. He just simply gives them, and he gives them, and he gives them, and he gives them, and he gives them. Jesus doesn't even make you take a drug test beforehand or prove that you are poor enough to receive his benefits, because he knows something about us. Jesus knows that we are all poor. We are poor in spirit, poor in faith, poor in every measurable statistic. This was something the Apostle Paul had to learn the hard way on the road to Damascus, finally leading him to declare in Romans chapter 7 that all have sinned and fallen short of God's glory. There is none who is righteous, not even one. Good works cannot avert your doom. They never help and save you. Instead, faith looks to Jesus Christ alone, who did for all the world atone. He is your Hosanna, your Savior, your Redeemer. All who have had long held the dream that God's law was given, that sinners like us should and could redeem ourselves by our own works and thus gain heaven, have now been stopped cold as Jesus comes not to help us with the law, but he has come to give us what the law could never give: salvation, eternal life. Hosanna. In Christ and by his work, the law has now met its Waterloo. For the law is but a mirror bright to bring our inbred sin to light, to show us our need of one who comes from outside of ourselves, who comes and does the work that we cannot do ourselves. The law reveals our guilt and sin and makes our conscience burdened, you see. But the gospel, who is Jesus Christ, when it enters in, forgives our sins and clears our conscience. The law that has so burdened us, never giving us peace, no comfort, no blessing, now comes to an end because of Jesus Christ, the one whose ride into Jerusalem we celebrate this day, the one that we declare to be our Savior, our Rescuer, our Hosanna. And so this week, we now move from Jesus' triumphant entry into Jerusalem. We move from there to Maundy Thursday, where on the night Jesus was betrayed, he gave himself in body and blood, bread and wine, to Good Friday, where we'd finally had enough of him and nailed him to the cross. And then we will come back here a week from today. For you early risers will be here at 7 o'clock and we'll hear the timpani roll as we celebrate what Jesus Christ has done, that he has defeated sin and death and put them behind us, that he has become our Savior. And so we see now how faith clings to Jesus' cross alone. And this week it leaves us to rest in Jesus unceasingly. So rejoice, people of our Savior. Shout, members of OSL, for behold, your King is coming to you, righteous and having salvation, gentle and riding on a donkey. Shout your hosannas. Declare to the world that your Rescuer, your Savior, has arrived, because this day salvation unto us has come by God's free grace and favor. Good works cannot avert our doom. They help and save us never. Faith looks to Jesus Christ alone, who did for all the world atone. He is our Hosanna, our Rescuer, our Savior, our one Redeemer. So shout for all the world to hear your hosannas, that your Christ has come and he has come for you and for the whole world. Thanks be to God. Amen.
I invite you to stand as you're able. It's time to make a little bit of noise. Let's proclaim what we believe, proclaiming our faith in this God who has come down to save us, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Hearing the call to return to the Lord, let us join the whole people of God in prayer for all who cry out in both pain and hope. We pray. Be with all who wave palm branches this day and walk the road to the cross, both near and far. For the mission of the gospel where your church is forgotten, for disciples wrestling with betrayal, for all who seek your grace, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Bless all who are preparing for baptism and those among us who are completing their Holy Communion preparation this week, that the means of grace may continue to create faith through the power of your incredible love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. End human trafficking in every nation. For children taken from their families, for men and women without hope, for governments and agencies seeking life-honoring resolutions, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Comfort the afflicted, for those imprisoned, for those waiting on death row, for all overwhelmed by sorrow, and for all who live with disease, chronic pain, and anxiety in this world, and for those among us in need of healing, especially Carol Williams and Linda Vershore, Lord, in your mercy. Enrich the children and youth of our congregation with an abundance of your Spirit. For each child in our community, for parents and guardians, for confirmation mentors and faith formation leaders, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Sustain the weary. For all who mourn, especially Diane Lorenz and family on the death of her father, Theodore, and Rosalie and Jim Ryan and family on the death of Rosalie's brother, Donnie. For all who yearn to be with you in paradise, for funeral home staff, for hospital chaplains and grief counselors, Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. To you, gracious God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your boundless mercy through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. You may be seated. Worship continues as we give back a portion of what God has given to us. And so I invite the children to come and help with a noisy offering. Let us pray. God, our provider, you have not fed us with bread alone, but with words of grace and life. Bless us and these your gifts, which we receive from your bounty, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. On the night when he was betrayed, having been anointed for burial at Simon the leper's house by an unnamed woman with expensive ointment, and having sent his disciples ahead of him to make arrangements for celebrating the Passover, while they were eating, Jesus took a loaf of bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, gave it to them, and said, "Take, this is my body. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took a cup, and after giving thanks, he gave it to them, and all of them drank from it. He said to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many. Do this in remembrance of me." When supper had finished, they went to Gethsemane, where Jesus prayed before being arrested. Gathered here and now, in this moment of remembering, we pray together for courage and faith and all that we will need for following Jesus using the words he gave us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. All who thirst, all who hunger, come and be filled with the goodness of God. You may be seated.
Thank you for joining us in worship at Our Savior's Lutheran Church in Sioux Falls, South Dakota. For more information about Our Savior's, please visit our website at oslchurch.com. We invite you to join us again next Sunday morning. Until next time, may God's abundant love and blessings empower you to share the good news of Jesus Christ.